Martin.
Yeah, thank you. So yeah, as mentioned, I have prepared those slides with Julian Stiller from the Humboldt University in Berlin. But in fact, I'm going to present the work that has been done by a group of experts. And in fact, we have spent like 7 months working on this. So I'm really happy to present this work on their behalf. So to start, so what about semantic enrichment? So what we have noticed in digital libraries, and also it's what we do at Europeana, so usually we are using automatic and manual enrichment to try to solve the problem we have with the quality of the data. So this is our main use case, I would say. So more and more you see digital libraries and other institutions trying to use enrichment to first standardize their data by linking to authority resource or some vocabularies available on the web to try to improve multilinguality coverage. So it was what Asuncion has presented in her keynote speech, how by linking to multilingual vocabularies on the web, how you can improve your multilingual coverage in your applications. It's also used to contextualize your resource, so when you are missing information about the context around a book, a painting, etc. You can also use this the enrichment to link to extra resources that would provide the context you need. And there might be many more other use cases, so I'm not going to go into all of them. But first, and also the idea why semantic enrichment is becoming more and more popular is also because now institutions are more and more adopting the technologies of the semantic web. So it goes together, this kind of adoption of this technology, while the web is now developing and more people are reusing those resources in their data. But first, maybe what is necessary to set the scene is to define what we mean by semantic enrichment. So for us, in our context, we articulate the definition around three different type of things. So first, for us, semantic enrichment is described as a process that improves metadata about an object by adding statements. So when you have your metadata records, and then you will link to other resources that are also described in a certain way, and then you will maybe add this additional data. This is the overall process that we call enrichment. You could also use enrichment to define the process of an application. So when you run an enrichment tool, you are also performing enrichment. And finally, you can also use enrichment to name the results of an enrichment process. So the new metadata you will create at the end of the process. So you will have, in a way, your source metadata will be augmented with the new metadata you have fetched from those external resources or data set you are linking to. And then to kind of to broader a bit this definition, you can also speak about enrichment strategy. So and in this context, you are referring to all the different workflow components that you are using and all the different processes you are using during this enrichment strategy. And in the literature, when we are speaking, so at SWIP this year, we had not so much talk about really linking to vocabularies, but quite often you might also hear other terminologies such as co-referencing or vocabulary alignment or contextualization or even annotation like today. And for us, this is also a type, all those different notions are also types of enrichment. So it's just for you to set up the landscape. So this is what I'm referring to when I'm speaking about enrichment. So what we do in Europeana, and this was presented already last year. So at Europeana, we are performing automatic enrichment. So this is an automatic process. So for example, in this description for this etching, you have a subject which is costume. And what we are doing is we are automatically linking to external vocabularies. And this, in this example, you have, for example, the terms costume from DBpedia. So what we are doing is we are automatically linking the string costume to the term from DBpedia costume. And then what we do is we are augmenting our metadata by fetching all the additional data that DBpedia is providing us. So for example, all the translation of the labels. So you have costume describing in different languages, and it's what you see in the box. So we are fetching those additional data. We augment the metadata from the source provider in a way, and we also index those information. And this is really important for Europeana because we need to offer multilingual services. So for us, it's a way of tackling the multilingual issue. So for example, if a user will search for costume in German, then you will be able to find this resource which has metadata in English. So this is our use case. But what we have noticed is when you do this process of enrichment in the wrong way, in fact, it's worse than if you have not done anything at all. So I said that we are using semantic enrichment to improve data quality, but in fact, you might make things even worse if you don't do the process correctly. So typically an example, you might include some semantic error into your data. For example, we had in Europeana some objects that were prints, so in German, Druck. And we had a target data set, which was a vocabulary used for environment. And Druck, in this vocabulary, referred to pressure from the physics sense. So what we did when we enriched automatically all our prints, Druck, with the vocabulary Druck for pressure, semantically we had completely derived from the original meaning. In the same way, you can introduce errors from a language perspective. So for example, India in French and in Latvian and with the same string means poison. So again, when we run our automatic process, because we can't plan what will happen, so then we had enriched all the India record written in French with poison, because and in French refer to poison in Latvian, and we couldn't notice this kind of thing. So when you do, when you have incorrect enrichment, so first it will lead in a way to the devaluation of the curated metadata that were provided to Europeana, and a loss of trust from our data providers, because they will come back to us saying, well, you do automatic enrichment, but you are messing up our data. So you propagate errors, so you can propagate errors to different language. And since we are using this enrichment within our index and within our services, so in a way it has impact also on other things such as our search results and or in a broader sense, a bad user experience. So it has a very important impact, and that's why you need to control this process in a very good way. So this was where we started from, and last year I had reported on this issue. So our conclusion was, well, we need to better understand the impact of the enrichment and to better understand the overall process and how we can fix errors within this process. So what we did is something that we don't do that often, and maybe we should do it more often in our community, was to compare and to do evaluation. So what we did, we ran a comparative evaluation with a group of 23 experts from the cultural heritage community around Europeana. And so we took an evaluation data set contributed by the European Library. So we got a data set that was quite representative in terms of the type of data, the countries represented by those data, and the languages. So something that was quite diverse. And we ran seven different enrichment tools on this data set. So at the end, what we obtained was around 1,700 enrichment that we have sampled and then manually annotated. So the goal was to, so we did the evaluation in a manual way, and the idea was to evaluate the quality of the results, so to determine whether the enrichment were correct or incorrect, and looking at different patterns. So the logo you see below are some of the enrichment tools we have tested. And for example, this morning we had the presentation from Pelagio. So we use Pelagio's enrichment tools as one of those tools we have tested. So I'm not going to go into the details of the comparative evaluation, but you can find all the details in the report. So there was some, as I said, the enrichment tools were run on the same data set. So here, for example, you can see, depending on the different tools, the coverage of the enrichment, and then how many enrichments you were getting per record. So for example, for the onto text, for example, in the dark blue one, there is a high level coverage of the enrichment and also a high coverage in terms of enrichment. That means per record, every time you have a value that can be potentially enriched, this was done. But then the question is whether this enrichment is a good one or not, because when you look at those graphs, you can think, well, it's pretty good result, but still you have to look into the details. So this is what we have done. And based on this evaluation, we have tried to extract from this experience some recommendations. So all the work we have done represents something like more than 100 pages of reports. So what I'm going to present now is just a little taste of what you will get if you read the report. So I hope after this presentation you will run and download the report. So we thought like 10 is a good number, so we have tried to provide. So I'm going to provide you 10 recommendations on how you should perform semantic enrichment. So the first one is, define your enrichment goals. You know, it can be pretty attractive to run enrichment on your data, but you have to define why you are doing it. I mean, you are not going to do it just for the sake of it. So first, try to identify what are the problems you are trying to solve. Do you want to normalize your data? Do you want to add additional information that you are missing? Are you trying to get to improve the multilingual coverage of your data set? You have to think why you need to do it. And then how you want to do it. So what type of enrichment do you want to achieve? So whether you want to have an automatic process, or whether if you have human resources, you might go for something that is a bit more manual and maybe calling for crowdsourcing, using crowdsourcing tools to try to enrich your data. So you have to think also in terms of investment and resource, how you would like to do it. Then you will have to already define from the beginning what you expect from the result, because defining those criteria will help you to evaluate the success of your enrichment. If you are performing enrichment without having already quite a good idea of what you want to achieve, then you won't be able to properly evaluate the result of the process. And then finally, what type of data you want as input or output. So you have to select your source data, you have to select your target vocabulary, you have to look into that, and then to see how you want this to be represented. So the idea is your enriched data should remain interoperable, so probably you want to find solutions that are already quite standardized. So to summarize, having clear goals from the beginning will help you to define your goal standards, what's in the perfect world, how your data should be after enrichment, and it will help you also to define guidelines later when you will perform the evaluation of your enrichment. Step two, you have to choose the right method. So as I said, you will have to define what kind of enrichment method and technique you want to choose to run your enrichment. So for example, if you have decided that you would go for a manual process, with the input from users, that means maybe you want a service that provides a nice interface. So for example, I'm citing here the example of the Culture Link tool, which is an alignment tool, which has this nice interface where you can define your alignment strategy by selecting your source, selecting your target data set. This is what you, the box you see. And then you can define the rules for matching. But the interface helps you, even if you are not a technical person, helps you to get more familiar and to play and evaluate the results. So so at the top you see the alignment strategy, and at the bottom you can see the results immediately, the results of the alignment. So you can already have a feeling, you know, is for example, so you have a concept violin enriched with a vocabulary, and you can already have an idea whether it's going to work or not. And then later you can decide whether you want to run it on the full data set or only on a part of it. Then you have to select the right services. So you have to take into account different things. So first, you have to take into account the semantics of your input data. So you will have to choose an enrichment service that recognizes a specific metadata scheme. So for the data set we have chosen for the evaluation, the data were represented using the Yopana data model. That means this is the data you are going to use as an entry point. And since you need to do your enrichment, you need to define rules, you know, like if you see this value in the subject field, then link it to that specific field from DBpedia. So you have to create those rules. So you have to be aware of the metadata format you are going to use. So typically, for example, if you have some SCSI data in entry, but you have something like GeoNames, which has a different format, you will need to do some mapping. Then you have to select a service that provides the output data in the desired representation. So first, the output of the enrichment service should ideally follow some standardized patterns. So you have several languages and standard you can use to represent enrichment, such as it's always full of acronyms. So like the NIF, the NLP Interchange Format, or you have ITS, which is the Internationalization Tag Set, which are languages that can help you to represent the enrichment. But also we have seen today, if you want to represent annotation, you can use the web annotation standard. So you have to choose, depending on how you want to use your enrichment result and how you want this result to be represented. So you might choose an enrichment service rather than another one. So if you have annotation and you would like the result to be formatted according to the web annotation standard, and one of the tools is doing that, so probably this will be a better choice. Ideally, the enrichment service should also publish metadata for the enrichment. So it's something that we are not always thinking about. And I know at Yopana we are pretty bad with that and we want to improve things. But ideally, when you do enrichment, you should have metadata about the enrichment process itself, such as the provenance. You know, you have this source data and you have enriched it with these services, maybe a certain version of this service with those enrichment rules. So you might want to capture those information, because next time you will run the process again, you need to remember, if you have a different result, you might need to go back to those information. And maybe also some confidence measure, you know, when you perform an enrichment and then you publish your result, it could be interesting for the user or your data provider to say, well, this is the result of an automatic process, and it has this level of confidence. And then the last important thing is the selection of the target data set. You know, the error I was mentioning, which was a vocabulary for environment, considering that Yopana is about cultural heritage, maybe that was not the best choice. So you have to look at the domain, the granularity, and you have to make the good choice. Then you have to define the enrichment workflow. So how you want to activate your enrichment workflow and how this process should be activated. So if you have someone running the enrichment tools, the person needs to know in which order to do things. So if you need to normalize some fields first, then you should clearly identify this. For example, clean this field before running the matching process. And the rules you are defining for the enrichment also need to be defined and documented. So if you have rules, take the spatial field and then match it with the geo-coordinates, this kind of rules need to be clearly documented. And also, a nice thing is also don't forget user-initiated enrichment workflow. So usually we tend to think about automatic solution, but in fact, calling for more manual processes can be also a good way to evaluate your results. Step four, you have to train the person that will do the enrichment because it might involve different type of people. You might have the expert that knows the vocabulary, that knows the source data. So if this person is running the enrichment, you have to explain how the process is going to happen. And similarly, if the person running the enrichment has no knowledge about the data, you might, in the same way, try to explain what is going to happen during the process. And yeah, the knowledge is in fact crucial when you will do the evaluation and assessing whether the result is a good one or not a good one. Then you have to test your enrichment workflow. So the enrichment service should be flexible enough to have adjustment made. So it shouldn't be a black box. You should have clearly identified the different components and you should be able to tweak all those different components to make sure at the end you will have a good result. Then you need to assess the quality of your enrichment against the goal you had set at the beginning. And in fact, and that's why the first step was really important, because only if you know what the best possible outcome of the process will be, you can do the evaluation only if you have this idea of how the data should look like if the enrichment has worked properly. So if you have clearly defined your goals, you should be able to see that. Then you should have an evaluation strategy. It's really important to evaluate the results. At Europanna, we had not done it that much, and that's why we had all this problem then going on in our services. So you have to define the strategy and to choose the right evaluation method. So you have to take into consideration different aspects. So first, you will have to define whether an enrichment is correct or not. But you might take into account factors such as the search performance, the user experience, the relevance. You know, an enrichment might be correct from an expert point of view, but if the user is looking at the specific information, then it won't be that good. So creating gold standards or annotated samples can be a way for you to define this evaluation strategy and have a better idea of how it should look like in the best world. Again, don't forget user-initiated workflows to have a look. So it's always good to have people coming in to check the result of an automatic process, and it's what we have done during our evaluation, having real people really looking at the data and assessing the results. And finally, so the two last steps, so you have to document your enrichment process and the learnings, because if a new person is doing the similar work after, so you need to have documented everything so that you can really maintain the strategy you have defined and the process you have defined. And you have to monitor your enrichment process. It's not because you have enriched your data once that you don't need to do the evaluation after, so because things are always changing, so your source data might have been expanded with new information, so you have an update, and suddenly you have much richer information. The target data set might change. I mean, DBpedia, Wikidata, they are doing updates every day. So if you have defined some rules, the rules you have defined might not be valid a few months after. So you have to, if you have defined your process in a good way, you should be able to tweak things and to improve the workflow and constantly monitor this this process. So this was the, quite quickly, because now I'm at the end of my time, so this was the main lesson learned from our work. Now I know you are all going to take planes or trains, so just before you go, download our reports and have a nice reading. Thank you.
Thank you, Valentina.